It's a crime to sleep in the city of Tucson. It's a crime to go to the bathroom at certain times in the city of Tucson. And it's a crime to peacefully assemble any time of day on public land. So those were, the past few years, those were really my mission to try to address those in some way.
So when I talked to you last, it was down at Safe Park, down here in downtown Tucson. And in that 5 years, a lot has happened. John.
Yeah, let's
try
this together, man. Hey, nice seeing you.
Nice seeing you, man. Yeah. It's been 5 years and a lot has happened.
Sure.
What, you made national news by getting, what was it, boxes with wheels on them? Tombstone?
Eventually they had wheels. At first they were just boxes without wheels. And we just, you know, moved them around with dollies and stuff like that. But I guess the final dimension was like 4 feet by 4 feet by 8 feet long. So, I mean, they were something to be desired as far as looks, but going from sleeping with just like a backpack worth of stuff and a sleeping bag and a pillow on a sidewalk for probably about 2 or 3 years at that point, like, it was a very big upgrade. It was a huge upgrade.
Wow. So you were sleeping on the side of the sidewalk. As described by law, you can only sleep on half of the sidewalk for over 2 years before you got the safe pods?
Oh, yeah. We got the dream pods.
Oh, they were dream pods.
Dream pods, yeah.
Okay.
And that was the name that was popular nationally. But, I mean, with Safe Park, I mean, it was a huge project. I mean, we dealt with thousands and thousands of people, so... I mean, we were stirring things up, getting in the news prior to the Dream Pods coming out. But definitely, I think once the Dream Pods came out, it was a physical manifestation of what we'd been saying, that we're winning in court, we won in court, and that there's things have changed around here, and we can now do certain things that weren't allowed before. So it was, for me, it was a wild ride. It was nothing but a blessing and a calling from God to really help as many people as they possibly can and really change the way that at least this city does things in regards to helping people. And I'm glad the conflict as regards to the lawsuit and all that's over. And now onto a new stage of a way to help people with more resources and more people buying into the fact that we have a little expertise that other organizations don't have.
Okay, and what do you refer to as the expertise you're referring to? Like what along the last 5 years have you learned that's most important?
Well, particularly is in regards to the laws that regulate the day-to-day life of a homeless person, no one in the city knows it better than John Cooper and I. I mean, literally. I mean, even our own attorney doesn't know the issue as well as we know the issue. So, like, having access to that type of information, whether it's a social service organization, the government, or other people that want to help out, I mean, that's a really good tool where we can tell them exactly what they can or can't do and tell them exactly how someone's rights may or may not be violated by taking that action. So, I mean, our hopes are at this point to put that knowledge that we've obtained, particularly legally, maybe even from a social service standpoint, and continue to help as many people as we possibly can, and set models that other groups can copy in other places, so that way all these the people that are left out and not getting the needed help that they need, the people that are dying, the people that are malnourished, the people that are sick, can get the help that they need. Because right now it's happening, and they're just falling through the net. So that's where our heart's at right now, I want to think, more than anything else.
Okay, and on a legal standpoint, were you able to make a moral argument, or did you pretty much have to work within the legal frame of the law?
Well, in this society that we live in, there's, I want to think, primarily three different dimensions that you're dealing with, or let's say three different branches, since we're, you know, we're in the United States. And one is the legal branch, the other is the political branch, and the third is the public or the networking branch. And you know, through this, through the time we've developed, at least in developing Occupy Public Land or developing Safe Park, you know, we've developed programs that take those different areas into consideration. And we're coming at it legally. Other times we're trying to get the news to do stories about our legal wins and coming at it, you know, politically. And other times we're like this, you know, meeting with, you know, our friends that are on Facebook, or just, you know, what would be considered everyday people, and plugging them into the stuff that we're doing, so we can get the word out there, or we can just primarily get as many people help as we possibly can on whatever that project may be.
Okay. And you've had some recent legal wins with the city as far as legalizing homelessness?
Well, over the past, I think, year and a half, the city's changed many laws that has ostensibly made it so it's not a crime to be homeless anymore. Because before, it was. I know as proof, because I got arrested 50 times in the past 5 years. And now, before, there were times that you had absolutely nowhere that you could sleep. So if you had to sleep and you didn't have money, you had to either walk around or stand somewhere, because you weren't allowed to sit or lay down anywhere in the city. Now the city has ensured that between 24 hours a day, there's a place where you could sleep in the city of Tucson and have your property. Also, they used to have what was called the 3B rule, which was you could have a backpack, a bedroll, and a beverage, and that has been completely thrown out, and now it's just an amount of cubic space worth of property that you're allowed to have. So a lot of these, like, what were oblivious policies that they had, or ambiguous policies rather, they're not even on the books anymore, and now they've refined the laws with the request or the suggestion from the federal court to make them so they abide by any constitutional scrutiny. So definitely from the legal side, we went through the process, which is a pretty simple process. You got arrested, we had a grievance with the arrest, we went through the internal affairs, they decided that nothing was done wrong, we disagreed with them, so we filed a civil rights complaint, got moved to a different court. Me and just another guy without a lawyer litigated it for 2 years on our own, and eventually we got it far enough through enough motions to dismiss that the judge appointed us a pro bono attorney, and then at that point we just wanted to use that preliminary injunction and any clout we'd gained to really set a model for how you can help people. And I want to think that, you know, it's a model that we got, we took pieces from other places, and I know you know, there's other models right now that exist that I want to think they sample parts of what we do. So that was the goal for us. So I'm glad to see that things changed, and one way or the other, you know, it's an ongoing fight, but you can do something. I mean, we have no reason to feel hopeless as individuals, because if you put your energy toward it and be willing to sacrifice anything, you'll get to the other end of the rainbow.
Well, walk me through it then. Let's say, hypothetically speaking, my wife kicks me out. I don't have anywhere to go. I grab a backpack in my anger and I leave, whatever. I'm homeless. I'm on the streets, hypothetically speaking. Where can I go to sleep legally?
Well, downtown specifically is a relatively safe space, because if you find a sidewalk that is larger than 8 feet, between the hours of 10 p.m. and 7 a.m., you can lie on that sidewalk without any obstruction or without any problem. Particularly, I mean, obviously at Safe Park, the downtown library right next to Safe Park, those are areas that, you know, I've established are safe areas, hence the name. So, and Pastor Dave, when he went out and stayed on the street with me for 3 days, He saw that, and in the documentary that we did together, he stated that before he had been homeless, he would think he'd go out in a wash or go to the tunnel away from everything, but experiencing it, he realizes how important a congregation of people or a lit place or, you know, a safe place is for someone in the exact situation that you're talking about, that just, you know, had a safe, comfortable place to stay yesterday, but doesn't today. So, yeah.
And so, from, say I'm staying at the library, what process would I go through? Say if I met someone like you or someone that could help guide me through this.
Well, pretty much if you go to the library and you talk to the other people that you see there staying on the streets there, I mean, they're going to help you. I mean, maybe not all of them. Maybe, obviously, like just like any other grouping of people, certain you'll gravitate towards certain people and others you won't so much. But that's the great thing about the streets, and one of the things that I loved is it's a community of people there. And once you're part of the community, you're part of the community. You know, and if you mess up, then you're going to be held accountable. But if you do right by people, they're going to make sure that you don't get steered wrong. I mean, the big problem is like the gap or the stoppage there where there is no bridge is the people on the streets aren't social service workers, and they don't know what the service really are, obviously, or they wouldn't be on the street. So filling in that gap is a need that I've assessed. But personally, if you go to the streets, and I'm sure you've experienced it in your life, I mean, people that lived on the streets or have lived on the streets are some of the friendliest people or some of the most charitable people you ever meet. So I mean we as individuals, we are naturally reclusive, you know, introverted people, like to be to ourselves. But when you're on the streets, when you're around a whole bunch of people, I mean, you see the great things in people, and you kind of, you get out of that, and especially when you need stuff, when you need to eat, when you need a place to sleep, you know, you learn to get out of that and start talking to people, and you realize how great people really are.
As far as being out homeless, what happens when you throw an addiction, any addiction, you know, into the mix as far as getting help beyond living at the park? It's a tough one.
I want to think it's safe to say a large percentage of Americans have addiction. So it would be as difficult with addiction in a house as it is not in a house. Getting over addiction, probably a little bit harder without a house, because you have a lot of more downtime and a lot of time where you just want to do something and you want to have fun and have a good time. But
and also being in a community where it's probably readily available.
Yeah, absolutely. But I mean, even when you're housed, usually people who have addictions, they surround themselves with other people that help them make that readily available.
Well, how about as far as getting services beyond just living in the park, like like going out to the mission and, you know, sleeping a night or two if they'll allow it?
It's there. I mean, like, these services, they're there, but there's two parts that are making it so they're not housing every single homeless person that exists. One, trust. And whether it's the social service workers or the government or the relationship between the social service organizations and the government, the homeless population doesn't trust any of the services. So, I mean, once you finally get them in there, they're set like a jet, but it's hard to get them in there. And then the second part is there's so many gaps and there's not too much cooperation between the services. So, like, if, let's just say I'm a veteran, I have drug abuse issues, and I have a family, and I'm trying to get stuff, diapers for my baby, and there's all these different elements. I got to go to four different places to get all this stuff situated, where I have a hard time even getting to one of these places because I don't have any money. Nonetheless, four different places, and not only four different places, but four different places, four different appointments. So we're talking about 16 appointments to get housing and get, you know, maybe set up on the track to get disability and all this stuff, when I'm homeless in the first place. So why would you even think that I'm going to go way out of my way for a process? So it's just, that's where the rub is with it. But that's where my mind and heart is at right now. I'm certainly not set on, you know, what's the next step for me in this cause, but I know people trust me on the streets. And I know how to navigate the services, obviously, because I get to drive a nice car, dress nice, and my family taken care of because of it. So
So you make money helping people then?
Well, I get disability.
Okay.
Yeah. And if I could teach other people how to navigate this process and teach them that they can trust this process, then they can be in the exact same situation that I'm in, particularly veterans. I mean, before, I've never been one to bang the veteran drum because I want to help everybody. I'm not just trying to help veterans, but...
Well, you're a veteran. You're a veteran yourself.
I'm a veteran, yeah. But I don't have a bias to that. I'm a human, so, right. You know, like, I have a bias to that. I mean, if you want to ask me if I'm going to go and help house dogs or cats, or I'm going to help house humans, I'm going to help house humans. So that's
you got something against dogs and cats then, huh?
I have a beautiful Chihuahua Terrier. I love her very much. I'm a house the hell out of her, love the hell out of her. But outside of that, right now, I have my hands tied. So,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And your car. You have a nice car.
I do have a nice car.
You're proud of it, huh?
I'm proud of it. Well, just, I mean, it's just a car. I have other vehicles as well. So it's just. It was, you know, in some regard, a matter of necessity to operate whatever I wanted to operate next. Like, I've been a business owner for pretty much 20 years of my life, so, you know, that's an obvious, you know, natural step for me, and that's what I'm doing now. What I've done even when I was on the streets, you know, I've been a business owner, so, you know, obviously certain type of meetings that I go to, I want to have, you know, a more presentable attire and a presentable look. And then, you know, if I'm going to go clean pools, and then I'm, you know, bring my pool van and dress like I'm dressed doing pools. So
yeah, I remember with the first interview you had, I would describe as maybe a third or fourth hand-me-down shirt.
Yeah.
You know,
for sure.
It was kind of tattered, little holes here and there.
Yeah, and like I told you, you know, I think it's off camera. You know, I'm proud. I'm so proud. Like, for especially how many people told me it wouldn't happen, and that I wasn't like. That I was down the wrong path, and that I was just so wrong, as a horrible person. Like, you know, I made it out of that alive in one piece, you know, didn't have to go to prison, thankfully. And I'm here, and, you know, I have my family's taken care of. I mean, and one of the things that really stuck in my craw is, you know, one of the guy I looked up, I wouldn't say looked up to, but a guy that I respected, one of the local journalists with the newspaper, did this story about me calling me a deadbeat dad in all intents and purposes. And
you kind of took that to heart then?
Absolutely. Just I was insulted that he didn't come to me first to ask me about the situation.
So you didn't know him on a personal basis? No. Or he didn't interview and come to this conclusion?
He'd interviewed me on several occasions in the past, but this one occasion, when he had it his heart set that he was going to paint me as a deadbeat dad, he didn't really come to me at all, and I just found out about all this information my ex-wife said through his article, and it was disappointing, but it definitely fueled my fire to not be as humble as I thought I would have been once I started receiving a little money and things came through, to show that I'm taking care of my family, that I'm, you know, I'm doing all right, that I was, when back in the day, and all the sacrifice I made and the struggles, even that, you know, my family made as well, it was, you know, for, it had value, and I realized that at the time, and I realize that now. So yeah, I'm not afraid to enjoy the fact that I got my life squared away.
Okay. What do you think in the last 5 years has been your absolute just biggest accomplishment then? Aside from family, I mean, as far as being an activist towards homelessness or a political activist.
Well, there's not too many people, probably in any city in the world, maybe, that can say they're one of two people that made it so it's not a crime to do something.
Okay.
So, like, granted it's a real bold statement, but I want to think it's safe to say John Cooper and I made it so it wasn't a crime to be homeless in the city of Tucson. So that's, that. I mean, and that was our goal. So to accomplish our goal is just, I mean, it's such a goal that big. It's humbling, again. I mean, it's just, I don't feel like I'm any, I know that I'm not any different or any more special than anybody else. I'm just, I didn't quit. I didn't give up. I went and made friends and figured out, you know, what I needed to know to accomplish whatever I needed to accomplish. So, yeah, again, I'm proud. I'm proud of the effort, and I'm proud of everybody that helped.
Some have accused you of being a poverty pimp. What is your reply, or what's your thoughts as far as being a poverty, or this label of being a poverty pimp?
Well, I've been accused of a lot of things. I mean, a lot of things. I was accused of a big time drug dealer. I want to think that that's the one that would be the most off, because like for so long I went out of my way to not, you know, even be obscured as selling anybody drugs. But it just, I've never met anybody who could truly articulate in a rational way how I am a poverty pimp. I mean, especially someone who lives without anything, with only a backpack worth of property for, you know, close to 5 years. Like, I personally would like to hear that argument of how that person could be a poverty.
You have nothing to use to yeah.
I mean, because even if, like, let's just say I stockpiled all that money for 5 years, and I buy myself a, you know, a 2010 Mercedes, not even new Mercedes, 2010 Mercedes, and, you know, I dress okay, like, that's a really big sacrifice. I earned it then. Yeah, you know, really. So, yeah, I've been called so many things, and good and bad things have been said about me over time that, you know, I just, of course I hear it, you know, like we've already covered, but I consider two different paths a lot, because they really put things into perspective, other than a star, but two different people's paths, Jesus Christ and Martin Luther King. And like, Martin Luther King's an easy one because it's right in reach, and he's a follower of Jesus Christ as well. But
Baptist minister.
Yeah, but it, you know, just like pretty much Jesus set the blueprint of how to like help people, how to be a good person, how to like the type of model, what you should strive for as a person. Obviously you'll never achieve it, but that's the model. I mean, it's really hard to make that argument, you know.
Well, and it's hard to achieve those, yeah. that
yeah. And you should,
the Jesus guideline, that's hard to achieve.
You never think you could.
Right.
But knowing, having, like, much like when you put together an IKEA shelf, or you're putting together, you know, maybe you're reassembling an engine, it's nice to have a blueprint or a map or some type of guide to help you achieve that. So when, you know, when I say to myself, like, pretty much my old mission used to be, I want to be a good person and I want to leave a legacy of being a good person. But now, after everything I've been through, my mission and my goal in life is to be a type of man my children are proud of. So, you know, whatever that means to me, like, one, Jesus sets the path of how I would accomplish that. Like, if I can lead a model like Jesus led, like, I know my kids would be proud of me, and they'd be so happy, and they'd brag to all their friends about their dad. So, you know, that's where I'm at, you know, with my thinking.
So to sum it up, maybe you're not so concerned of how other people view you. It's more on how you view yourself.
Well, it's just, it's a matter, within anybody, it's a matter of being okay with yourself. And I was okay with myself when I had nothing. I'm okay with myself when I have a little bit. I'm okay with myself when I have a whole bunch. I'm okay with myself. Like, I really am. Like, I know the type of person I am. The people that are close to me and that are around me, which I have a lot of people that are close to me around me that, you know, I'll exchange a beer with or smoke with or just, you know, hang out with on a regular basis. Probably thousands of people in the past 5 years. That love the hell out of me, and I love the hell out of them, and they treat me great. I've never had anybody walk up to me on the street and punch me in the face. So, like, so they can, people can say whatever they want. I mean, words are words, and Like they say, sticks and stones can break your bones, but words can never hurt you.
Well, you came out to a Tea Party event. I respect the hell out of you for that.
Well, I'm like, that's the thing that I think has people, particularly when I posted something yesterday about Trump, and people are so confused about me. Like, everybody wants to put me in a box, like I'm either a Green Party or this or that or this, but I'm not me. I'm me.
Just you're like, an individual.
Yeah, and like, I'm
proud to be an individual, I assume.
Very, and I'm proud to have the freedom to take on whatever friends and whatever acquaintances or whatever partners or whatever associates that I choose without feeling like I have to discriminate against them because I'm in a certain box.
Because of differences in ideology, huh?
Exactly. And I mean, just like, it's real, I've said it for years, it was real hippie when I said it before, it's real hippie when I say it now, but I love everybody and I love everything. I mean, if you look at anything or everybody, there's at least one thing that you can find that's just so lovable about them, that's amazing about them, that either makes them unique from everybody else that, or makes them, you know, beautiful or, you know, whatever the case may be.
Everyone usually has a unique positive quality.
Exactly. No matter how many, like even Trump, no matter how much I disagree with him, the dude axed the TPP yesterday. You know, that was something that myself and many others have railed against for years, ever since 2011. So, like anybody who is objecting to that at this point, unless they have a valid argument toward how the TPP could have helped, like I'm not going to play that game, because this isn't high school. This is the real world, and you know there's a lot of serious stuff that needs to be done. So we need to take it seriously.
Well, I applaud that definitely, because it seems like people are so closed-minded that they won't listen to the opposition. They won't listen enough to find any redeeming qualities, you know, but yet they're judgmental as if they know something, you know? And I find that true. There's always usually redeeming qualities in most people.
I think so. I haven't met anybody yet that's not.
Well, right. I've met a few people, or maybe I can find very little redeeming qualities.
Yeah.
As far as,
there's,
you know,
some people, there's only one. You know, I definitely know a lot of people in my life. There was only one. I mean, I've certainly had so many people that rubbed me the wrong way in my life. But regardless, I mean, they, one way or the other, they're human, and I respect their rights and I respect their liberties. You know, and I respect them as a human being. I respect their opinion even. So that's how I play it. And everybody doesn't have to play it the way that I play it. But so far, I've lived a pretty happy, positive life, despite a lot of negativity that's, you know, been tried to be hurled my way.
Do you think, you know, I have this faith that the majority of people are in fact good, and it seems like media puts a spotlight on the smaller, much smaller minority of people, and it scares the crap out of everybody to even go out and talk to your neighbor. Do you think that's illogical to be scared of people in your neighborhood and people in your city?
I want to think that maybe the big problem people have is they think trust is a light switch. It's an on and off thing. But with trust, there's different levels, and one has to establish, you know, what that procedure is, and one gaining more trust with them. And usually, you know, it's spending time with people and exchanging stuff with people and exchanging tasks and doing errands or chores or helping them on tasks and stuff like that. So, I mean, I don't think you have any more fear to be afraid of the guy who lives next door to you than I did the guy who slept right next to me on the sidewalk at Safe Park. So, yeah, I want to think, I mean, like I said, the big thing is just getting over that initial. And maybe the point isn't not being friends with every single one of your neighbors. Like we said, there's certain people that you just don't get along with. But to start reaching out, because the community is where it's at. I mean, I don't think it's on the scale of needs necessarily, clinically, but it should be. Because certainly when I have more community, I'm a lot more healthy mentally, emotionally, and physically than I am without it.
Okay. You do need some time to yourself, though, obviously. Everyone seems to.
But we have an abundance of that. We have an abundance of, I don't have time to go out because I'm going to watch this movie, or I don't have time to go to this event because I'm not feeling well, or there's an abundance of time to yourself. But okay. making time for community, there's been propaganda, and I want to think an asserted effort to prevent us from using public lands. But this used to be. That's how this used to be. That's how England, the old all of, you know, old Europe, a lot of other countries still are, where public lands used heavily, and people are there having picnics and throwing frisbees and, you know, just spending time in every, you know, major city in those countries. So, like, that would be my hopes for this place, because the thing I've learned is the exchanging of ideas make things great. Whatever that is, whether it's a project or it's a movement or it's whatever the case may be. So, I want to do everything I possibly can, continue to just bring people together, and let's make amazing things happen.
In the last 5 years, I read an article that you got busted for selling marijuana.
Well, they charged me for 7 different things. So it's like kind of like a marijuana conspiracy racket. They tried.
Well, how did it go down? I heard that you sold to an informant. So someone was buying from you that actually was a policeman?
Or? Well, what they did is they sent 6 undercover cops to pose as homeless people for about a month.
For a month on taxpayer money. Okay.
For a month. And I know it was a month because I remember, like, the people that are list, or the interactions that are listed in the grand jury testimony explains to me exactly what happened, when they were, how they were.
And they just lived with you and slept down there. You wouldn't have known the difference, huh?
Some people were there sometimes, some people weren't. You don't really know. You know, it's not like you, like, take roll call every day.
Right.
So I think one of them I even gave a dream pod to. Like, I gave them a place to sleep. So they did that. And so these are people that I trusted, you know, and I, you know, probably even smoked with and just hung around. We talked. And they didn't even get me necessarily, like, I had this big thing of weed and here I break you off, like, a whole bunch of transactions. What they got me on was I told them where they could get it.
So you didn't sell them to them directly?
No.
Did you give it to them, like, for free? Or?
No. Well, yeah,
well smoking, yeah, okay. Yeah. But you didn't, there was no money going from their hands to yours.
In one instance. But that was just, I mean, the guy that I was doing it for was right over there, and he pretty much just, like, made me do it. Like, his leg was hurt, so he couldn't walk over there. Can you go over there and grab it for me?
So it was almost like you were baited. Oh, my leg hurts. Can you please help me out?
Certainly, I had an entrapment claim on this case. And I mean, initially that was what I was thinking would be my defense, but entrapment claims in court are like, have 1-3% odds. So I was either going to play the odds of an entrapment claim and face up to 25 years in jail, because up to 5 years for each charge, so 35 years in jail rather, or take a plea of 2 years of probation.
And the police don't get in trouble for buying the drugs because they're just pretending to buy it?
I'm guessing it goes into the evidence or it goes into their impound later, but...
I mean, if it's illegal to buy drugs and the police actually bought drugs, aren't they guilty of a crime as well?
I want to think there's certainly federal court cases that would support that they're within their legal right to do raids and to do undercover investigations like that. Like, the Supreme Court has already said that a cop is allowed to lie to you if you're the person who's under criminal investigation.
So yeah, it's like prostitution. If there's a police officer pretending to be a prostitute, shouldn't they be guilty of prostitution? And then the entrapment laws, because that really is entrapment, it doesn't apply. They find some legal loophole to get out of it. Huh?
Wow.
Well, it's the mandate for what is entrapment is you have the propensity to do it otherwise, but you were coerced into doing it by a government agent. So, like, when with me, I went out of my way to make it known that I wasn't a drug dealer. Especially, I have homeless people who ask me every day if I could.
You were just a reefer smoker.
Yeah, okay. And I would smoke them out, you know, for sure, if they really needed it or if that was the case. Especially if it was like, I'm a patient, so I know that some people need medicine, and I know, and I'm smart enough to know when, you know, somebody is, their mind's not in the right place, or their body's not in the right place, or they're just, they're not in the right place. So, I mean, and I didn't see anything wrong with sharing with people, and that's not where they got me. Where they got me was the other side of my sweetheart, where I'm all about giving people whatever they need. Like, if you need a blanket, I got you. If you need a sweater, I got you. If you need shoes, I got you. If you need a computer, I got you. If you need a guitar, I got you. And
need a cigarette,
I got you.
Okay,
exactly. Yeah. And if you hey man, I can't freaking find a dub, a 20 sack of anywhere, you know where I can find one. And then, you know, with those guys, that's why they said six after me, because I kept telling them no, because I didn't know them. And I told them, I'm not a drug dealer, I'm a homeless advocate, man, quit asking me that. And and that's on in the files. And they eventually just, you know, once I get to know somebody far enough, once I, you know, build that trust, and they made within that wall of trust, and me telling them, oh yeah, I know exactly who you can get it from. Of course I know who you can get it from. So
it's a shame. So they got seven counts. They, yeah, got you.
It was intent to sell marijuana. So pretty much, like I said, I told him where to get it, and
you pleaded guilty to one. They dropped the other six.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
And then I got 2 years of probation. And then it's $2,000 in fines all in all, but
$2,000?
Mm-hmm.
Holy cow. So now, when did you actually get your license, your medical license?
I got my medical marijuana card in like June of 2016.
Okay.
So about 6-7 months ago. And, I was on probation, so I got my card. I didn't.
You had to get out of probation before you could get your card?
Or? No, I'm on probation still.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and I didn't smoke actually for a year and a half. So I was on probation for like almost a year and a half before I actually started smoking. Actually, no, on probation for I think 7-8 months, but I didn't smoke for a year and a half because once I got busted, I didn't smoke until I got my card, and because I was thinking I wasn't gonna smoke anymore at all. But I was just like, and I worked at the VA and have a job, got my life together, all that fun stuff. But then as a businessman and as a creative person, I was stuck. And I couldn't think of anything creative. I couldn't write. I couldn't think of any business ideas. I was just stuck. So I was like, well, I'm gonna just go get my card and I'm gonna try smoking and see if that helps.
So it acts as an inspiration to you as well, huh?
Well, it's my medicine. Like, for what, like I was diagnosed with ADHD when I was 5 years old. I mean, not to mention all my other my medical history in regards to my combat in Iraq. So, like I need it, and I don't. I'm able to annotate it to creativity, but there's a lot of things that I need it for. But that was one of the things.
So when you were five, that would they prescribe you Ritalin?
Yeah, I was prescribing pretty much from 5 to almost 15. You know, I was taking meth or speed, and you know, all intents and purposes. So
yeah,
it was to be just, you know, smoking weed or medicating with weed, whether it's, you know, edibles or oil or.
So they prescribed you Ritalin to deal with what, attention deficit disorder?
With ADHD, yeah.
Okay. Mine was attention deficit disorder, learning disability, and hyperactivity.
Oh yeah. Yeah, pretty much you're creative and you spoke out a lot. That's what if we were to name it what it really is, that's what it is.
And how long did you take Ritalin? Do you have an idea?
10 years.
10 years?
Almost 10 years, yeah.
Wow. I was lucky enough. I think the first year that they prescribed it to me, I told my mother no.
My mom wasn't listening to my advice on it. I was five, you know. So, you know, my parents are military, so they're gonna do what they're gonna do. But yeah, I kind of weaned myself off of it when I was 15.
Did you find out that you went through any depression during that time?
I don't know. I was a kid, so I really don't really remember like how my feelings and like my internal stuff.
Like, did you have any suicidal actions or anything?
I remember being like a zombie and never really wanted to do anything, just vegged out in front of the TV and not, certainly not being creative, even less creative than I am, you know, sober or, you know, whatever you want to state it as, so.
So we're down here at the 420 Club. You do have to have a medical card and a membership. Do you now volunteer here?
A membership. It's the first time is free, and if any additional times, it's $5.
Okay.
So I mean, even at that, it's a pretty good deal because, like, you have somewhere downtown where you can go and you can medicate and hang out is all day if you want, all day and all night for $5. So I mean, that's a pretty good deal. And if you pay that, you get parking here. I mean, you can't buy parking during the day down here for $5 for the day. So yeah, there's that. And then it's $42 a month for membership and then $420 a year. So, and I'm a member here now, but like I work with them then work, you know, really for the place because they're doing their own thing. They've been here for 2 years going strong and they don't need my help. And they don't need my help to run things around here. So it's really cool though. It's a really cool place. And it's kind of like, as soon as I got here, granted, you know, Anthony Potter worked here. So someone that I was familiar with was here. It felt like a clubhouse, like my buddy's place. So it's been a pleasure. And then we'll be, this Saturday, we're actually going to be starting an outdoor cafe right there behind you. And we're going to be selling concession items and then like homemade items and like gyms and stuff because the gym show's going on. And then you know, a couple other just like kind of subsidiaries of the 420 branch, because the big thing that happened to me with this whole getting arrested and the city pretty much outed me that I smoke marijuana, you know, I'm a user of marijuana, it's no question. So they put me in this fight of the war against drugs and the war against marijuana. And I have to, now I'm, you know, on a different front from homelessness, and I'm going to step in and try to see what I can do to make it at the minimal so a patient isn't a criminal. Like, a patient shouldn't be criminalized for doing his medicine. Like, and yeah, in every circumstances, there's extenuating circumstances, but there's too many patients that are getting dragged out of their homes for doing exactly what the Medical Marijuana Act explicitly says that they can. The marijuana fight has been going on in Arizona since 1996, really, to start. And when medical marijuana got passed, and then they wanted to play funny business in 1998, they actually got it clarified a little bit better, and it's you know, been smooth sailing on that for the most part. But
didn't it pass in like 97, 98? Like,
it passed, but then the legislation like gutted it, and then in 98.
So they didn't make marijuana legal for medical purposes in 96.
They did, but there were so many stipulations on it. It wasn't much different than...
It wasn't usable.
Yeah, it was really hard to get from the dispensary to your house. It was very, you weren't allowed to use it outside of your own personal domain, and just like a lot of other stuff like that, like I said, just made it a crime to be a patient, you know, which is like it.
And now we're here, what, 20 years later?
Yeah.
And it couldn't get passed for personal use. Do you think that bill should have been passed, or do you have more criticism?
There was too many people, even especially from the marijuana community, that objected to it.
What were some of the objections?
They didn't give users or personal use people even the same type of rights that a medical patient has now. And most people that are for recreational use, they're not looking for a whole bunch of regulation or a whole bunch of funny business. They want it to be as easy to deal with as any other type of flower. So I think that's with the bill that was put forth, there was too many compromises that the group circulating the initiative made, and the marijuana community wasn't willing to make those compromises.
It seemed like if you crossed the line, though, if you crossed a certain amount, they would come down on you harder than current laws on that.
Yeah, definitely. Well, and that's another thing, is like there was still a lot of criminal prosecution within that, where the idea would be just a fine that one would receive if they had a certain amount, particularly like under something like 5 pounds or something like that. Anything less than that, I mean, we're not dealing with big time criminals. We're dealing with, you know, primarily impoverished people that are just trying to eat and trying to survive in some capacity.
You know, one of the things I want to ask you is, in the last 5 years, have you seen an increase in homeless population? And what's your thoughts on that? Like, as a personal survey of the homeless population?
I'd say, if anything, there might be a slow, steady growth, but I'd say it's steady. It's pretty steady, and it's certainly not going down. That's what I've seen.
Do you see a specific population that might be increasing? Or
based off all the research studies I've read and just what I've seen in the past, since 2011, it's pretty consistent. It seems like as quickly as they're getting people into housing or into shelters, there's that many people coming, new people coming to the streets. And the big thing that even like the people on the streets that have been around for a while make mention to is every season you get half to three quarter new people on the streets. So a lot of, if I go out there right now, 75% of those people out there have no idea who I am. So that's pretty common. But the numbers going up and down, it's really hard to tell, especially the street count they're gonna do isn't gonna help them much. But based off of just my impression and my interaction with the people on the street, which I still do interact with people on the street a lot, it's same people I saw 7 years ago are still here now.
Okay. I know in the city I grew up with, Rockford, Illinois, and up here in Phoenix, they said they've housed all the homeless veterans. That their homeless veterans are no longer an issue because the city took care of them. Do you have any thoughts on those statements?
In what city?
Well, in Rockford, Illinois, up here in Phoenix. I mean, one of the things Lewis Arthur was saying was, he was saying, Phoenix is saying they got all the homeless veterans housed. He'd go out in the washes, way out in the, and he'd pull some out here, and he'd say, okay, look, here, we still have homeless veterans.
Yeah, it's not even that hard. You don't even have to go to the washes to find homeless veterans in Phoenix here or Rockford or wherever. It's just in places, particularly like Phoenix, because I know, because I've tried to set up there on several occasions, something like Safe Park. Their laws ain't no joke. They ain't no joke. And they've, no one's challenged it, and they might be challengeable, but like, you can't go and do some stuff like I did down here up there, and you'll be in jail real quick, and they'll hold you for a little while to say you learn your lesson. So but they do, you know, it's a bigger city, so they do have more services, so you know, those getting people into them isn't as hard, you know, and people are a lot more willing to get those services if they realize that if they don't, they're going to go to jail. So that's what's happening in those places, and they want to count it to this like you say, you know, the saintly system and the saintly doing, but it's really you know, more evil than it is good. And that's where it's up to, you know, activist groups like ours to ensure that they're not all evil.
Okay, well, John, thank you very much.
Thanks,
sir,
for interviewing me.
Oh, anytime. It's complete pleasure.